This is a video for medical students at the University of Arizona to provide them with instruction on lumbar puncture and the key portions of that procedure. First, you must identify the interspace where you're going to perform the lumbar puncture. The site that's usually chosen is the L4-5 interspace. Typically, this is located in the midline at approximately the same height as the posterior superior iliac crests of the pelvis. Once you've identified the interspace, you need to aseptically prepare the field using prep sponges and a prep solution. The prep sponge should be used in concentric circles, starting at the interspace where you anticipate you will make your needle puncture. And then you want to make 3 concentric preps. Always prep a larger field than you will actually need to ensure good aseptic technique. You will then position your sterile drape so that your field has the intended interspace clearly and centrally located in the field. It is a good idea to repalpate the interspace to make sure you are where you want to be. You will draw up some anesthetic solution. Usually this is lidocaine and it's administered with a small needle such as a 22 gauge. First you will anesthetize the skin and then you will infiltrate the lower tissues such as the ligaments and muscles and other subcutaneous tissues. You may wish to use a longer needle to reach these deeper tissues.
Just one.
Note that there are 4 plastic test tube containers for collecting cerebral spinal fluid. And we want to get them prepared with the caps loose so they're ready to go once we actually initiate the lumbar puncture procedure itself. You will also be assembling the manometer, so you won't have to fumble around with this when the time comes to measuring opening pressures. We will also take the precaution of now hooking up the manometer to the stopcock itself. Once you're ready to begin the lumbar puncture procedure, with the lumbar puncture needle, it's important to get the bevel of the spinal needle in the right position. There is a small clicking mechanism on the stylet that ensures that the bevel on the needle is facing upwards towards the top of the head.
This has a little dot, and this dot lines up.
We advance the lumbar puncture needle with the stylet in place. Very often there's the slight sensation of a pop when the lumbar puncture needle passes through the dura and into the CSF compartment. Once there is egress of cerebral spinal fluid, we can hook up the manometer. We close the manometer to the outside world, that is to air pressure, and open the manometer up to the patient. And you will see that we can see the rising of the cerebral spinal fluid in the manometer, and this gives us the opening pressure once the level of cerebral spinal fluid stabilizes. In this case, it's reading about 11 centimeters of water down to about 9.5. Now it's time to collect the 4 test tubes with cerebral spinal fluid. Usually we put a cc or 2 in each test tube. The first and the 4th test tube are sent for cell counts. The 2nd test tube is sent for chemistry so that we can get things like electrolytes, glucose, and protein. And the 3rd is sent for cultures and sensitivity for bacteriologic examination. The stopcock on the small piece of intravenous tubing helps us to manipulate the stopcock without worrying about affecting the lumbar puncture needle in place. Once we've filled all 4 test tubes, it's time to remove the needle. The stylet is replaced back in the lumbar puncture needle, and then the needle is withdrawn. The lumbar puncture needle is never moved forwards or backwards without the stylet in place. Once you've removed the needle and the lumbar puncture procedure is over, you'll rub the spot where the needle was removed and apply a Band-Aid. Once again, just to review, there are four test tubes of cerebral spinal fluid usually collected. Numbers 1 and 4 go for cell counts. Number 2 is for chemistry, such as glucose, protein. And number 3 is for bacteriology, for cultures and sensitivities.